Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Hopkinton Historical Society. We're really happy to have you here this evening for our second collaboration with the Hopkinton Public Library on local authors. And my name is Ann Mattina. I'm president of the Historical Society, and we have a... Oh, thank you. thank you. We have a lot of great events coming up soon, and I hope you can join us for some of those. I'll just briefly mention them, and then I'm going to turn things over to Heather Backman to introduce our speaker this evening, Nancy Haynes. On February 19th, Mary Niaz, who's sitting in the back, is going to do a discussion on and presentation on her book, which is called Stones, Pennies, and Prayers. Which is the history of the St. John the Evangelist Church, and she's looking at the Irish Catholics here in Hopkinton. So that's Sunday afternoon, February 19th at 2 p.m. On March 1st, we're going to have a great event. We're going to kick off Women's History Month here at Hopkinton Historical Society. We're having a presentation by a woman named Judith Black, who is presenting to us Lucy Stone, who's a very famous Massachusetts woman. She's the first woman to graduate from college in Massachusetts in the 1840s. She was an abolitionist, anti-slavery speaker, a woman suffragist, very interesting woman. She's actually the first woman to refuse to take her husband's name upon marriage. She married Henry Blackwell, and any woman who chose not to take her husband's name after that was known in the 19th century as a Lucy Stoner. So Lucy Stone actually spoke here in Hopkinton on Hayden Row, somewhere on Hayden Row, to the Hopkinton Anti-Slavery Society several times in the 1850s. So Judith Black is going to do a return appearance of Lucy Stone here to us. And then the other thing we're very excited about, that's March 1st, 7 p.m. here at the Society. The other thing we're very excited about is March 12th, which is a Sunday afternoon. We're going to be doing Notable Women of Hopkinton. And at that event, we are having some notable women, current notable women, including our superintendent of schools, our director of the library, Representative Carolyn Dykema. They're all going to be presenting to us historical women from Hopkinton's past. And we're going to have a visit from Lady Agnes Surridge, which some of you know her story. And she will be part of this event as well. And this is being co-sponsored with the library as well. So we hope you can come out for any and all of those events and look for the, you know, some advertising and signage out front regarding all of those events. Oh, I do have to mention, it's very important for me to mention that those last two events are courtesy of a very generous grant from the Hopkinton Cultural Council. So, thank you. I'll turn everything over to Heather.
Thank you.
And I think I recognize everybody here, but just in case you don't know me, my name is Heather. I'm the Adult Services Librarian at the library. And thank you all for coming out tonight. Many thanks to Anne and the Historical Society for working with us again. This is a really exciting collaboration for us, and we're looking forward to keeping it going. We're also very pleased to be able to have a space to do programs while we're in our small temporary location. And if you haven't been to our temporary location yet, please do come visit us. We're at 65 South Street. If you go down by the Price Chopper, hang a left, we're up the hill, sort of as you start to come around the curve and see the light on the left. Before we begin tonight, I have a couple of quick housekeeping items. If you have a cell phone with you or anything that might make noise, please silence that so that we can enjoy Nancy's talk uninterrupted. There are evaluation forms for this event on your seats from the library. If you wouldn't mind taking a few moments at the end of the evening, just to let us know what you thought. That would be very helpful to us in continuing to offer events that are interesting and useful to the community. And if you are not getting email from the library and you would like to, we have back here, along with some pens if you need any, a sign-up sheet for our newsletters. We have a monthly newsletter that goes out on the first of the month, and we also have a program alert email, which will remind you 1 to 2 weeks in advance of our upcoming adult events. We're very, very pleased to have Nancy Haynes here tonight to speak about her new book, We Answered With Love. Nancy is the former owner of the Vintage Books Used in Antiquarian Bookstore right down the road. I was telling her earlier that I wasn't very familiar with the town, and I was driving down 85 and saw this huge sign that said bookstore, and I went, yes! And then I discovered it wasn't a bookstore anymore, and it made me very sad. But I hear it was wonderful, and I'm very sorry to have not been able to make it there. Nancy and her husband have given numerous talks about Quaker history and have curated exhibitions of rare books and materials about the Society of Friends in conjunction with the rare books libraries of Wellesley College, Bryant University, and the University of Rhode Island. Nancy's also the author of the children's book, Approved, a story about Quaker meeting for business. And copies of that and We Answered With Love will be on sale here at the front of the room at the end of the talk. So with that, thank you, Nancy, for joining us tonight, and I will turn things over to you.
Thank you. Let me make sure I turn this on. So tonight I'm going to tell you a story about patriotism, courage, and love and in World War I. It's not the typical story because it's based on pacifists. They were the people who chose not to fight but still felt like they needed to do something to serve the suffering people and to be of service in the, during the war. Now let's see if I can, okay. Their story is based on a collection of letters that we picked up about 15 years ago. It's unique in that it's one of the most complete collections we found of letters from this period from pacifists, both doing work overseas and at home. So it tells the story from both points of view. Both of them are doing pacifist service during the war, but very different experiences. Leslie Hodson, now this happened 99 years ago, so in 1918. Leslie Hodson was a sophomore at Harvard. He was an English major. He was born in Canada, but when he was very young, they moved to Brooklyn. And he grew up in Brooklyn, went to school in Brooklyn. And he was attending Harvard on scholarship because his mother was a housewife and his father was a stenographer. So they, you know, they were not a wealthy family, but he was a hard worker. He was very popular. He was in drama and music and ran cross country and had, you know, just very active in the school. Mary May Peabody, was a junior in 1918 at Radcliffe. She's from an old family, not the Peabody family. That her father, the Peabody line of her father's line is from New York, but the May family is an old New England family. Her mother's cousin was Louisa May Alcott, so it's that family. So she had a lot of cousins. A lot of her cousins were Elliots, and that they were the big congregational ministers in the Cambridge and Boston area at the time. Her parents were divorced, and so she was living with her sister and her mother in a boarding house. They were running a boarding house while she was in college. So she was at Radcliffe on scholarship also, majoring in English and French, and helping out at the boarding school. I mean, at the boarding house. They met doing drama, but they really started dating at Christmas when they sang in the Appleton Chapel Christmas choir. And they sang together and started a really great friendship. And Leslie, who was 19 and just, he fell madly in love and started writing letters back and forth, you know. He said, for one thing, he said, how weak and futile my poor little verses. How can they or a million poems shadow forth my love? It seems to sweep over me like a splendid rushing current and delight in its power to hold me silent. When I am less strange to its glorious flood, I may be able to call out to you above it. And he wrote those, and she always answered, We're just friends. We're really good friends. Don't get ahead of yourself. But they maintained a really strong friendship through this period. The war had started, America entered the war in 1917, in April of 1917, but by early 1918, the government realized that they were going to run short of officers. So they directed the colleges and universities to require military training for college men so that they would have a cadre of officers if the war extended very long. So Harvard became a military school and military training became mandatory. Leslie was a pacifist, a longtime pacifist, and refused to join the military. So he had to take a leave of absence from Harvard. And Harvard let him. He was hoping to return after the war. But he didn't want to just go back to Brooklyn and hang around. So he got into, through Mary's efforts. Mary was at that time volunteering with conscientious objectors. And she heard about a new Quaker unit that was forming to build houses for refugees in France. That's the symbol, that's the black and red star of the American Friends Service Committee. And that was just forming, and he was accepted to the unit. So he left Harvard with plans to sail to France to build houses for refugees. His brother, Ronald, also applied to the unit, but before he could get accepted, he was drafted. Ronald was an absolutist, conscientious objector. He refused to do anything to aid the military. So he ended up spending the war in prison. He was tortured, he was beaten, he spent many nights in the hospital. The military officials were not very kind to conscientious objectors. They felt like they were traitors and cowards, and they even were afraid they might be pro-German, so they were really harsh on the COs. But Ronald refused to fight, and he decided he was going to take this stand. And so he was in prison awaiting court-martial. He'll come up later in the book, but during the spring, before Leslie went overseas, he got to go down to the camp prisons and visit with his brother a little bit. And he reported on some of the conditions and some of the attitudes and the strength of the men who were conscientious objectors and in prison for their faith, most of them. He was very strong. He felt it came out of his faith that he could not take a life. Finally, in early July, Leslie got his sailing orders, and he sailed on the Rochambeau. It was a French ship. The Americans were using using whatever ships they could find, and a small number of unit members got passage on this. It also had some Polish military, some French Blue Devils who had been on a fundraising trip through the United States. The president's son-in-law, Francis Sayer, who had married Woodrow Wilson's daughter, was on the ship heading over to France to build more YMCA canteens. He was at that time a director of the YMCA. And he reports a lot of fun. They had talent shows, they partied, they played games, they sang songs. It was a really nice voyage, although at all times they were aware that they were traveling under military escort, that they were surrounded by destroyers, and they knew that it was a dangerous crossing. And although none of the people who went over with the Quakers were killed, I can't remember the number, I'm sorry, but a large number of ships were sunk in the Atlantic doing the crossing from Boston or New York to France. We don't have any pictures of him, or very many pictures of him. When his papers came up for auction and the person bought them, none of the family pictures were there. So this is just showing you what the uniforms look like. The men in the unit, in the Quaker unit, wore uniforms. This was to make them not stand out and to kind of hide the fact that they were pacifists there. So they did wear uniforms. They weren't allowed to proselytize. They weren't allowed to talk about their pacifism, but they demonstrated it in everything they did. Leslie was first sent to Sermaz in France, and that's a picture of what the village looked like. And what he wrote about it, he said, "We passed through Chateau Thierry on the way here. Some parts of it are badly damaged, and shell holes, trenches, barbed wire, and cemeteries are thick about it. After it, we passed several villages, more or less demolished. We came into Sermaz after nightfall. The town was burned in 1914. Some of the walls of the houses are standing, others are grass-grown ruins. It was in German hands only 6 days, then they were driven out. The Hindenburg line is only a few miles from here, but the Verdun drive did not reach this far. Many of the inhabitants have begun to live in temporary houses." For here, the greatest part of the friend's work was started. And so that's what the village looked like where he was assigned to work. And people were living in the ruins. They were living in cellars. They were living in caves around the village. They were living in makeshift tents around the rubble. So the Quaker unit, the men, started working, and they were building houses and community centers and schools for the village. The parts were manufactured in Quaker-run factories. There were two of them that were run jointly with the British Quakers that were pre-manufactured the houses, and then they installed them. And there's a house built in the middle of the rubble, so that's the start of one of the neighborhoods. And that's another little part of the village, and you'll see the little bee boxes. They also were trying to bring back some agriculture to the region, because if you saw, the lands were pretty much destroyed, and wherever they could, they were trying to bring back some kinds of agriculture that might flourish in the area to help the residents. There's another unit worker, one's on the roof, and so he spent the fall of 1918 building houses. Mary stayed at Radcliffe, so she was back in Cambridge. Not only was Harvard a military school, not only did they have mandatory ROTC, the Naval Radio School moved into Harvard. And at one time they had like 5,000 sailors there. Most of the dorms were filled with sailors, and the whole Cambridge Common was covered with white tents where all these sailors lived. So they were also doing their exercises around the campus. Mary writes, they partied with them. You know, they'd have dances, and the Radcliffe women would go party with the Navy boys. And Cambridge was basically a military town. In October of 1918, the flu hit Boston and Cambridge very bad. It had started in probably Kansas. It moved around the world, but it was really hit Boston because it was a port where troop ships were arriving. And so these were very crowded. So there were young men crowded in ships. They were arriving on the port. If one person got sick, the whole ship got sick. They were coming off the ship, heading right into ambulances. They took them to Fort Devens, and for a period of 3 or 4 weeks, I think that 3,000 people a day were dying at Fort Devens. I mean, it was just enormous. 50,000 people died worldwide. 50 million people. 50 million people died worldwide. More American soldiers died from the flu than died from the war itself. And it hit Cambridge and Boston especially hard. Mary and her sisters got very, very sick. They were close to death. Fortunately, they survived, or we wouldn't have a book here. But but she had a lot of time to lay in bed and listen to the more wagons going down the street. I want to read a little thing she wrote. She said, "The sun shone into the room where Helen and I lay, and we could hear the funeral processions clattering by at frequent intervals up Brattle Street. Then the children in the next yard would scream and laugh with joy at their play. How strange it all seemed, an enormous vacuum filled with beautiful abstract truths and a multitude of tiny details. I could not make myself believe that if I were not here, not there, things would go on just the same. And when I went down to the square the first time and saw the life and bustle, I was shocked that the world could be so heartless and carefree when hundreds were dying and being killed. Yet it is just this circle of life that keeps things going. Any one of us is really of very little importance as long as there are thousands of others to take up the tasks and go on. How wonderful life is, so fragile and short. So here's a picture of the infirmary at Fort Devens. It's the men in that picture are getting better, but they had dying men in all the barracks and in the halls and everywhere. It was the event, the things I've read about it, it was pretty horrific. And it hit in France too, but not as bad. And Leslie was fairly lucky in that regard. They were in uncrowded little villages away from the cities. So it didn't hit them very hard, but the Quakers did run ambulances and operated clinics in some of the towns, especially when there was an epidemic, an outbreak in that town. The other thing they did with these ambulances is they set up maternity hospitals, because most of the hospitals had been destroyed, but even though a war was going on and most of the hospitals and clinics had been turned over to people who had been injured from the war, women were still having babies. So the Quakers ran several maternity hospitals in old estates. Big chateaus became maternity hospitals. On the 11th day at the 11th hour, November 11th at the 11th hour, 11th day, 11th month, 11th hour, the armistice was signed in France, and the war ended officially. This is a picture of some people celebrating. They're riding a car through downtown Boston. Mary and her friends got up and caught a trolley, and they went to the church and gave thanks because they're and then they caught a trolley and went into Boston very early in the morning. They were dancing in the street, gathering people. They went to the steps of the city hall, and they were all singing La Marseillaise, and I can't pronounce French, but dancing in the streets and really celebrating. She and her friends got all caught up and raced back to Cambridge, and they were running around Radcliffe Campus, and they ran through a lecture that was still going on. In fact, she says it was the lecture she should have been at. The professor wasn't too happy about it, and she got in a lot of trouble. But she went to her, so she got reported to the dean, but she said, and I think this is really nice, if I can. Miss Booty said we should have waited for the legal holiday next day to express our enthusiasm, as if spontaneous joy could be bottled up and preserved for later use. And she also said, Miss Peabody, if the college people do not keep their heads at a time like this, what can we expect of others? And I said, Miss Booty, if people are not going to show their joy naturally and in the heat of the moment at such a great thing as peace, then the world will more willingly tolerate war. So she was a little, and that was her dean. She got in a lot of trouble with her dean, so. Here's another picture of celebrations in Boston. And then here's a picture of a parade. I think that one is actually from New York. But the next day was the official parades in Boston, in Cambridge, in New York, all up and down, all across the country. In France, they were also celebrating, but their celebration was a little bit more subdued because they still had to deal with all the devastation. And so the Quakers gave the unit workers option of leaving because their contract was till the end of the war. Most of them stayed, and they decided to concentrate their efforts in Verdun, which is really one of the hardest hit areas in France. And so they decided to pull in all the efforts that had been going on in other places of France because they felt that the need was so great everywhere, but if they didn't focus their efforts, then they would be spread too thin to really make a difference. That's a picture of that's one of the fields outside Verdun. There was no agriculture available in that area anymore. And it would be generations, really, before they would be able to farm some of those areas. There were ordinance all over it, parts from cars, from tanks and all that kind of thing. So it was just really a tough, tough situation. But the Quakers decided that they would do the best they could in that area. There's a picture of one of the, they had a few women in the unit, and she's, one of them is working with a man who lives in a little underground lean-to that he had built, and that's where he was living. That's an elderly couple in front of the one of the houses that were built. And I'm going to show you a couple neighborhoods. They, after they got, that's a little hard to see, but that you can see that they planted trees, they put sidewalks in, there were community centers, they built schools. Some of the unit members even spent time teaching children how to play. The children had been in a wartime zone so long that they didn't know games and how to play, so they were teaching them games and songs and playing with the kids. They were also helping the women set up sewing circles and all the things they needed to reestablish community. They were, when they had fields that were able to be cultivated, they brought in tractors, they were they brought in other equipment, and they were trying to reestablish the agriculture. And they provided a lot of the manual labor because the soldiers, all the young men, had gone into the military. So the people left in the village primarily were women, children, and the elderly. So they did a lot of the backbreaking work. This is a blurry picture. These are from 1919, so, and they were little snapshots, so the quality isn't really great. But the American military was pulling out of the area, and they had what they called dumps. They threw all their leftover materials into this big pile and told the Quakers they could have it. They had paper, they had equipment, they had truck parts, they had food, they had bedding, they had all kinds of stuff, and they said the Quakers could use it and have it. So part of what the Quakers were then doing was digging through this dump, trying to find good things. Someone said in a couple days worth of work, they got something like 500 pounds of building nails out of this. Leslie found a printing press and some paper and inks and was using it to do some publicity work. Then what they were doing, when they would rescue items from there that were useful, is that next picture? No. Oh, that's a car, one of the cars that they had. And so the cars that hadn't been working, the trucks, they got car parts out of that, which was really good, so they could get all their transport going. And the French government gave them the use of a train to move parts around. So that was really helpful. Their goal was to bring supplies to the villages and anything they could bring and get them to a place where it could be useful. But to ensure that the people reestablished their communities, they didn't give it to the people. I mean, they gave some, but for the most part, they sold it at a very low price. They helped each village set up a community cooperative store. And the French people worked with the Quakers to distribute these materials. And when the village had gotten established enough, they turned the store and all the inventory over to the village, and the village ran it themselves. So they were really trying to get the community up and running. They didn't want the community feel like this was charity. There's a really cute story that it's not in the book, but it came out of this time. A little girl went up to one of the workers, and she said, "I have six sous. Can you build my grandmother a house?" And he said, "Well, it's only going to cost 4 sous." And she said, "Well, do it, please." So the unit built her a house, and went. The little girl gave him the 4 pennies. And she was so proud of herself because she had bought her grandmother a house. And so they were really trying to do that kind of thing to make people responsible for their own life and feel like they were, living again, that there was a life for them. There's a group of children running to get supplies and help out. Mary, meanwhile, was back on campus. She was, during all this spring, she was She moved on campus. She was living in Barnett Hall on the Radcliffe campus. I don't know if any of you know Radcliffe. And she was an anti-war activist. She was a radical. She was a socialist. She was a suffragist. You know, she loved causes, and she worked really hard. She reports, I'm not sure what my next picture is. Yeah. She reports heavily on the anti-sedition work that was going on. The government got very worried about what was going on in Russia with the Bolshevik Revolution, and they were really afraid that Bolshevism or communism was going to take hold here. And they overreacted. They were raiding the dorms of Harvard students who were activists and arresting them for having seditious materials. They broke up some of the printing presses of these of people who were posting pro-socialist messages. She was very active in that, and a lot of her friends were. So she in her letter, she talks a lot about some of what her friends were doing, the ones who got arrested. Several of the people from Harvard spent 10 years in prison. They were in prison during the war, and they spent over 10 years in prison for promoting socialism. She also was very interested in union organizing, and she really thought she wanted to do something to help labor, work in a settlement house, become a union organizer, or teach in a working man's college. These are from the textile strike up in Lawrence. And she was following that. The day her sister and her mother went up to Lawrence to support the strikers one day. And she had a test, so she stayed at school. But that day, on the way back, anti-union thugs overturned their car, and they all fell out, and they were hurt, but no one was killed in their car, but they had some of the organizers with them. And so it was a really dangerous time, but a lot of middle class and upper class women were very involved in the trade union movement, especially with regard to child labor and women's labor. And here's another picture from the Lawrence strike. That's their marching in the strike parade. This is a picture of the Radcliffe campus. So Mary was doing a lot of union work, socialist work, radical work, but she was also doing drama and partying and finishing up her degree, taking exams. She reports all that, and she graduated, which was in June, and that was pretty exciting. And so a lot of the springtime is worrying about what she's going to do afterwards. You know, looking at the options for women at work, and also Leslie, who they'd been wooing he'd been wooing her in letters, and they were falling more and more in love through their letters. In the spring, they were talking about the nature of marriage, and she wasn't sure she could be married and have the kind of career and kind of future she wanted. Because at that time, once you got married, a woman stayed home, and she didn't want to do it. She wanted to teach or do something. So they talked about that. They also talked about the nature of service. Leslie felt that to live a life of service, he needed to kind of go down where the people are. He needed to build houses and ride tractors and entertain children. She felt that she could be of service by protesting bad government policies, by advocating for labor reform and trade unions, for advocating for education. And they were trying to negotiate how they could mesh their different views of service and their different views of marriage. So that was all going on while she was trying to graduate, but she did graduate. At the same time, this is really part of Ronald's story, but I think it's really interesting. In Verdun, the military gave the Quakers the use of German prisoners. It was a voluntary thing, but most of the German prisoners were really happy to have something to do because they were bored. So they helped the Quakers dig through the dumps and clean up and build houses and do all that thing. The Quakers were not allowed to pay the prisoners because they were prisoners of war. So Ronald and two other members of the unit visited each prisoner, took their picture, had them write a letter, and then after they had visited all the prisoners who were working for them, they went to Germany and they visited the families of each one, gave them the letter, the picture, and the wages they would have gotten paid if they had been allowed to pay the soldier. And the people in Germany were suffering just as much as the people in France, so a little bit of money really helped. So that was what Ronald did after the war when he was let out of prison. And then in July, they closed down the unit. The Quakers felt like they had done what they could do. They had turned all the cooperative stores over to the villages. They said goodbye to France and closed the offices. This was the American Friends, it became the American Friends Service Committee, and they moved on to projects in Poland, Austria, and Russia. Some of them did, and different places. The American Friends Service Committee still is active today all over the world doing service projects. And the people of France erected a memorial for the work of the Quakers in the war. And it was a statue of some French citizens. And then after the war, Leslie returned. So he went back to Harvard in the fall. He went back to school. He finished his degree in 1920, class of 1920. Got his PhD at Harvard and became a professor of literature. He taught at several schools, Columbia and Yale, but he ended up around 1940 at Haverford College, which is a Quaker college. And then he became a fellow at Yale until his retirement. He was a specialist in Shakespearean histories, Shakespearean scholars. They got married on Christmas Day in 1919, a few months after he returned. A funny thing is I have a newspaper clipping. About a week before their wedding, Mary was arrested for handing out Union literature in front of a lingerie factory in Cambridge. So she kept trying. I guess she didn't have to serve much time because they did get married a week later. They were married for 72 years.
Wow.
They both lived into their mid-90s. They died about a year apart. And that's their story.
Wow. Wow. Wonderful. Did she work after
she marriage? Taught at Shady Hill School for a couple of years.
Okay.
And then she became his research assistant. And he did a lot of research in England. Every school break, he'd go over to England and research. So she did research for him. She also became interested in Renaissance music. And she would put on Renaissance music programs and teach Renaissance music programs. And that lasted all her probably till retirement. I want to read one more quote before I quit. They were interviewed by the local news. They were living in New Haven, outside New Haven at the time, but they were interviewed by the local paper on their 70th wedding anniversary in 1989. And the article says, Mary and Leslie Hodson reflected on how they sustained the joy and wonder of their Christmas wedding day throughout their married lives. You need a love and you need a dream, Mary said with conviction. Something to sacrifice for, something really important to live for. Life is so wonderful, so joyful. We've always looked for and found the beauty and truth in love. So that's what drove them for their life. They never really did a whole lot of major service projects after that. They were always involved in some small way with political action and local service.
Same what point. Inspired you to write this?
About 15 years ago, we picked up this collection of letters As you know, as many of you know, we were rare book dealers down the street. And our specialty was books by and about Quakers. And so a dealer had acquired these letters and said, are you interested? They have Quaker content. So we, yeah. But we started reading these letters and just fell in love with the couple. I mean, the letters were well written. Both of them were very literate, so they were well written. They were charming. It had a love story. It had events that I hadn't heard about. You know, I hadn't been paying much attention. So we found it fascinating. And I just decided that their story needs to be told. They have a story in here that hasn't been told and needs to be. So that's how I got started. And it took me 15 years to get to this point, but I did it.
So how did you get all these pictures?
A lot of them came from the American Friends Service Committee archives down in Philadelphia. And some of them came from the Cambridge Historical Commission, some of them came from Radcliffe College, and some came from Harvard University College archives. Anywhere I could find them.
Are they in the book?
Yes. Yep.
Yeah. Did they have children?
They did not have any children. She got very sick from the flu, and she had a relapse in the spring of her senior year. And we think that it just affected her. So they didn't have any children.
What a shame.
I know. But I talked to one of their nieces who was at the time in her 80s, about 7 or 8 years ago. I visited with her down in the Philadelphia area. And, I think she was the only surviving niece at that time. And I've talked to some of the grandkids, the great nieces and nephews.
How did you know about doing all the research?
That was the fun part. I don't know. I'm sure Linda understands. You do a little research and starts snowballing. But I read a lot of books to get started. And then I spent weeks at the unit archives down in Philadelphia. I spent 3 or 4 days at the Harvard archives reading all I could find about the classes of 18, 19, and 20, and at the Radcliffe archives. And talked to anybody I could find who knew anything about it. And it was fun. The kind of little funny things got me sidetracked. One of the men that Leslie worked closely with was a British man, and I just blanked on his name. Anyway, he and his friend, who was also in the unit, started the Nonsuch Press. Have you heard of that one?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, they started the Nonsuch Press, and they had worked together in the Quaker unit. And so Leslie's first two books were published by the Nonsuch. I think it was 2 of the first 5 books were Leslie's by the Nonsuch Press. So that's, and so then, and those members happened to be part of the Bloomsbury group with Leonard Woolf and Virginia Woolf and that whole gang. So I met Maynard Keynes, so I started reading all that. I got sidetracked all over the place. Historical research is fun. It really is. You start finding a little bit and you start pulling threads and it just takes you all over the place. Yeah, Linda.
I was just interested in the relationship between the military and Quakers. So accepted them as a unit during the war?
Yes, what they did, the Red Cross had responsibility for relief efforts in France. So the Red Cross is a government unit. So the military gave Red Cross people authorization to travel in the war zone. It turned out that the Red Cross director at the time, Grayson Murphy, had gone to Quaker schools. He wasn't a Quaker himself, but he had gone to Quaker elementary and high schools, and I think he went to a Quaker college, so he knew the Quakers, and he agreed that they could work under the auspices of the Red Cross, but not under the direction of the Red Cross. So the Red Cross helped them by helping them get access to the war zones. They intervened with the military on that. They also helped them with some fundraising and stuff, and through the whole process, the French director of the Red Cross attended the Quaker board meetings and the Quaker director attending the Red Cross meetings. So they worked together. Some Quakers or some pacifists felt that the Red Cross was kind of a quasi-military group. they weren't really military, but their goal was to make it easier for military to do their work. So they did a lot of the things that supported military, like they ran canteens, they worked at the railroad stations helping to load people off, load injured soldiers off trains and stuff. So the Red Cross was doing more direct service to the military, and the Quaker group did not want to do that, so the Red Cross made it possible for them to just do relief work for French citizens.
Do you think that they would have been involved in that way in any other wars? Was that the only time they did that?
They did a lot in Germany during World War II. This is beyond this, but in the early 20s, under the auspices or under the direction of Herbert Hoover, they set up a feeding program for children in Germany, so that the Quakers ran this feeding program to feed children. Hitler was one of the youth that were served by the Quakers. So in the late 30s, there were Quakers working in France, and because he had such a favorable response, he let the Quakers meet with them. He let the Quakers get some Jews out of France, but that all stopped around 39 or 40. But at least for a few years, there was a good relation there. So that work continued, but I think the collaboration with the Red Cross was just this one time.
Yeah. I believe the Quakers served in a non-military role, Civil War.
Yeah, they did. In fact, some of the Quakers even fought in the Civil War.
Which sort of preceded the Red Cross. Mm-hmm. It didn't exist. It was formed during the war.
Yep.
It really didn't have any structure.
Any other questions? Great. Well, thank you for...